Firefighters battling around the clock tonight, homes already destroyed.
Scorching 21.
Fire season has started in the western United States.
This morning, the West on fire.
Fires across the state.
There is a state of emergency in parts of Northern California.
Here in San Francisco, a fire to the north recently covered the city in ash. This is what some of the cars in my neighborhood ended up looking like. It was a flashback to the huge fire last October that terrorized the region and became the most destructive fire in California history. But fire season never really stopped in California. It's a 12-month occurrence now. And maybe the most frustrating thing about wildfires is that there's very little wild about them. In ways big and small, wildfires are a thoroughly man-made disaster, which means it's going to be up to us to stop them.
We did two things to look into this. First, I sat down with Mike Flanagan, a wildfire expert at the University of Alberta in Canada. He told us about all the ways that humans are making wildfires worse.
And two, we piled our video crew into a car and headed for fire country to see what Flanagan was talking about and to try to see a wildfire for ourselves.
So, first lesson, people start fires.
So, globally, on average, we see 350 to 450 million hectares burned by wildfires every year. That's about the size of India.
Lots of those fires are intentional. They're often used to clear-cut land for agriculture. But humans are mostly to blame for accidental fires, too.
Here in the U.S., we spark roughly 84% of them. In California, 95%.
Causes of accidental fires run the gamut. Firecrackers, campfires, or something as common as a car pulling onto dry grass. But a huge lurking culprit? Power lines.
Power lines played a major role in the fires in Northern California in 2017. Power lines can come down in strong winds, or trees can blow into power lines.
That's an understatement. Cal Fire investigators say electrical lines and equipment sparked 16 of the big blazes that killed 44 people and burned 250,000 acres in Northern California in October 2017. And Cal Fire linked 15 of those 16 specifically to power company PG&E.
The best solution here is to bury the power lines underground. But that's a huge project and no one's jumping at the chance to pay for it.
There's many, many miles of power lines and whose responsibility is it, within municipalities, or if you have a private acreage, it becomes a little fuzzy.
This is Coffee Park, maybe the hardest hit community from that record-setting fire last year. It's still unclear who was responsible for this one, but we are all paying for it now. In billions of dollars in damage, in lost homes, and worse.
And of course, the primary impact is human life. People died because of wildfires.
PG&E said in an email that, quote, "The loss of life, homes, and businesses in these extraordinary wildfires is simply heartbreaking," and that they look forward to reviewing Cal Fire's reports.
Next, people make fires bigger. Wildfires are only wild until they reach populated areas, and people have made it too easy for the fire.
Some studies estimate that more than 40% of new houses are popping up in fire-prone areas.
But what's more, California's housing crisis is driving people to cities' borders and beyond. That puts more people in fire's way. And it makes smaller, controllable burns trickier, which are crucial to keeping these ecosystems healthy and preventing the slow buildup of fuel.
If you have a landscape that has lots of human activity on it, it's difficult to allow fire to take its natural course because it will bump into a community or an industry. There's so much human activity on the landscape, it's hard to let fires burn.
Flanagan argues that if we're going to build right up against fire-prone land, we should at least build in a buffer.
Golf courses are generally a really good fire break. Ball diamonds, soccer fields, football fields. All these areas are generally very good fire breaks. So if you plan them to put them on outskirts of your community and be like the first line of defense against wildfire.
And finally, we've all made fire season worse. The reason so many fires can start from a tiny exhaust spark is that so many of these areas are tinderboxes. And for that, we may have climate change to thank.
As the atmosphere warms, the ability to hold moisture increases exponentially. This means evaporation, evapotranspiration increases dramatically. And this means our fuels will be drier unless we get increases in precipitation.
Studies estimate that for every degree the temperature goes up, you need 15% more precipitation to offset all of that evaporation. And we're not likely to get it.
Researchers project that drought risk in California will only get worse as global temperatures rise.
We're doing an uncontrolled experiment on our climate system, and there could be some really nasty surprises.
So besides reducing our carbon footprint, how do we fight back against wildfires? Well, bury power lines, build fire breaks into communities, do more controlled burns. But Flanagan also thinks that sometimes we do well to take the humans out of the wild entirely.
Every human-caused fire is preventable. If you keep the people out of the forests or the wildlands, then there's no human-caused fires. Forest closures work. They're not popular, but at times it could save us a lot of grief.
In other words, if human-caused fires are preventable and humans cause most fires, then this is a problem with a solution. If we can actually learn lessons from the blazes that we've already started.
Humans need a bloody nose or two before we change our behavior. And we've had quite a few bloody noses, so it's time to start changing our behavior.
Thanks for watching, and we have a new video coming out every Tuesday, so if you haven't already, please subscribe.